Good morning, everyone. Before we start with the introductions of the sessions of today, there's a few announcements. So one of them is that, as you know, according to the program, tonight is the conference summer school dinner, and we had originally planned the orientation game to do that before that. Now the weather forecast seems to be so bad that sort of the whole orientation game seems to be during a big rainstorm. And the planning now is to have a voting on the mattermost on whether to postpone the orientation game to tomorrow instead of today. So keep an eye on the mattermost, and we'll keep you informed about when this happens. So this will then be announced at the afternoon plenary, or if the vote is clear, then through the mattermost when this will happen. Right, that was one. The other thing I wanted to mention is that if you looked at the program of Thursday and Friday, so we had this situation with Tom Hengel, not really spontaneously, but not in the end, not showing up in the program where he had originally planned to do four sessions, and we could fill up two of his sessions by Marius, his GDAL Cubes activities, which pretty much overlapped, sort of matched to what Tom had in mind to do, so we could assign students there. There are two other sessions on Thursday and Friday that I volunteered to fill up, and they're now cryptically called Etzer Pebersma Art Development Session. And if you look at the assignment of students, zero persons have been assigned to it. That is not because I don't want anyone in there, but that is because that they don't match any sort of prior program, right? So, and it's also not yet very clear explained what's going on there. The idea there is that I want to sort of sit down with those interested to discuss how we, there are two topics actually I want to work on in the near future with whoever is interested, and that we want to sit down and discuss what the problems are and how we're going to approach that. I'll talk a little bit more about and prepare something about that tomorrow and the day afterwards, but so you already have an idea. So the Thursday session I want to talk about is our global project, basically that now got funded by the Art Consortium, which is basically getting rid of our sort of GIS approach to geographic data. So geographic data means latitude, longitude, coordinates, and the GIS sort of attitude is looking at those as sort of as a box from minus 180 to plus 180 and from minus 90 to plus 90 and in a square, which is not entirely the case, right? Our world is an ellipsoid or a sphere. And there's a lot of things that actually go wrong if you do that. One of them is what Michael talked about on Monday, is if you have polar regions, you need to do something clever. And there's all these kind of ways where Antarctica is represented in order so that it looks reasonable on one way or another. And this whole, in my view, this whole thing comes from history, from GIS doing this all the time, and now we all accept it, we do it this time. And now there are a couple of GIS that actually take a fresh look on things. For instance, what is it? Google BigQuery GIS, where you just throw in your data and latitude, longitude, and does everything on the sphere. So there's no sort of hurdle of any boxes that end at 180 or that end at 90 or something like that. It's all spherical geometry. And so 20 years, 30 years ago, this was too expensive or too complicated to do, one of them, I don't know what it was. And right now we are stuck with that legacy, and this will be an attempt to get rid of some of that. So we will discuss approaches and how you do things. You need to rethink things like bounding boxes, right? Bounding boxes are basically the ranges of your x and y coordinates. If you do ranges of x and of latitudes and longitudes of Antarctica, you don't include the South Pole, right? Because it's not it's not in the boundary of Antarctica. It doesn't cross the South Pole, so it doesn't sort of include it. So you need to think of other things, other ways of finding them or of caps and so on. But anyway, we'll talk about that tomorrow longer. And the other aspect for the Friday development, our development session, the topic there is extending simple features with time information. Yeah? So what happens if you have a spatiotemporal point pattern? So we looked at time a lot in the STARS project, but that's for array data, so where you have regular time series. So for each feature, essentially, or each grid cell, the same time sequence. But now if you have, like, whatever, disease cases or crime cases with a location and timestamps, how are you going to handle those in a reasonable way? So anyone who is interested in participate in these sessions, which will be dominantly discussion meetings, then more than anything else, and maybe we can do some hacking, some programming, prototyping, or whatever, is welcome to go there to join me, discuss that. Right now we have four speakers for this morning, and we'll start with Marcus, right?
So, good morning, everyone. I would like to rush through the presentation we gave last week at the Phosphor-G in Bucharest about GraphGS in the cloud, just an overview of what we do, so-called Actinia processing. This presentation has been done by Carmen. She's to the right. She prepared it, and she's one of the developers of Actinia, which I will introduce now. This is most of our gang in Bonn. And yeah, what is it all about? So in some years ago, I mean, this idea of bringing algorithms to the data is nothing new, but we thought, why not exploiting the GraphGS functionality for that? As some of you at least have realized, GraphGS comes with a lot of stuff, which is probably relevant also to Sentinel data and others. But maybe not being ideal being used on a desktop, we thought of why not putting everything into a REST API. The original name was GRAS, yeah, GRAS as a service. But since that's from marketing speech not so easy to pronounce, we renamed it then eventually and called it Actinia. So GRAS in the cloud. Those who have been attending my talk yesterday and Vero's talk yesterday know that GRAS comes with a specific format with location, map set, and so on concept. This is also somehow adopted in this Actinia or reflected there. And we have so-called modules or the commands, which is a rich set of different methods. It's not unlikely other GIS software, of course. And examples here, vector clipping, segmentation, time series processing, or the standard GIS stuff, and so forth. So, what about putting a REST API on top of that? Yeah, we have the functionality of GRAS as it is, but we built a REST API around. We need to have then the possibility to look at those data, list them, of course, to enable GRAS usage, maybe have some user management there. Not every user should use everything, but restricted by commands to be used or by amount of pixels to be processed, because we need to keep in mind that cloud computing costs money. I mean, any computing costs money, of course, but you bought your laptop, you get energy for free here from the university, at least for free for you. In a cloud context, you have to order machines to run them, and they will happily charge you something. So it's a good idea to have some user control there in order to avoid that the user just burn your budget unless they pay for it. Then you want to have locking in order to avoid conflicts that one user can overwrite stuff of another user. This is already built in GRAS. Yesterday I mentioned that you can store GRAS data on a network drive and the entire team can use it at the same time. So there are two concepts which are relevant. We have the persistent data and we have the user data, which are like non-persistent, which means in the upper box you would store the base cartography and say, okay, this is the elevation model. You put it one time into your cloud space, and then it's available to selected users. And you have the user DB where people do their own stuff, compute things, which may disappear, say, after 24 hours because it costs resources, so they can download it or do whatever they want, and then it gets deleted. On the right side, you see basically the different grass nodes, which we call Actinia node because it's in the cloud context, and they do the working. So we have the workers there and the grass database, and they interact somehow. And the entire job management is done in a Redis database because you have to keep track on users, who can do what, which jobs are executed, did they fail or not, so the job status and all this kind of stuff that is stored there. What we use as a technology is Docker here, and we have already been deploying it on OpenShift infrastructures in a rather large way in Kubernetes, and we also use Terraform. Terraform is a software which lets you order new machines and set them up. For example, you have a heavy job, you are splitting your data into pieces like tiling or whatever approach you use, and then you want to send it out to different nodes. In this moment, these nodes have to be ordered, installed, or being pre-installed by Docker images and then brought up and put into the network that they are visible to Actinia. And this is done, among others, through this Terraform software. Well, and OpenStack we have also used, so you can see you can launch this Actinia stuff on a number of different infrastructure types, let's say. It also works on Google Cloud and on Amazon if you insist. Then we have a load balancer. So you can imagine different jobs come in, they're different machines, they need to distribute the workload somehow, and this is done by a job manager. And the user is sitting somewhere and controlling the entire thing from remote. So if we look at REST, I will in the session talk a bit more about what it means. You can send so-called requests. It's not much different from calling a web page. Yeah, if you in your browser put in a URL, then you get back something. Yeah, this is a HTTP request. And here we have something similar. And if we say get locations, we send it to the server, then we retrieve back, for example, this answer. And this format here is called JSON. There you see another example. You want to know something about a detailed map set, which is like a subdirectory in which data are stored. Then you can retrieve those information, and you can see available map sets, standard, out, permanent, Landsat, and something else. This is machine-readable, that's the idea of JSON, but it's also human-readable at the same time, at least more human-readable than others, other formats. You can also look at data. Say, show me all data available in that map set here, so the elevation model and so on. And you can also render them. You see, you attach render there, and then you get out a map. You can also download resources like GeoTIFF or vector format, that's also possible. Well, so user-defined processing, do not only want to look at stuff, but we want to also compute something. We send so-called process chains, which are like one command after the other, chained together, stored into this JSON format, and I will show how to generate such lists in an easy way. And then you can go ahead and combine all the tools you have there on the system. And that's not only GRASS, but it can be arbitrary Python scripts, GDAL. We have also put in Snappy, for example. So the ESA Snap software comes with a Python interface. We have a RepDet, so we have Sentinel-1, Sentinel-2 processing chains there. You can compute NDVI or do some radar differences mapping or whatever you can imagine. You can control everything from command line using the curl software, for example, and then you send the credentials. This demo user is public, so it's something we play with later on. And then you send as a file the process chain, or you send it as a JSON string to the server here, and then it does an asynchronous processing. So it means the JSON is sent to the server, it sends back a status, okay, I received it, or it is, I received it, but it is not garbage what you sent, I can't read it, or it is going into processing. And then you do so-called polling, which means you query, okay, are you ready, are you ready, are you ready? And then at some point you get something back when the job has been executed. You get back, okay, everything is successful, here is the result, and then you can retrieve it. Or you can feed it, that is the idea, into a different process system. So what I want to say here is all this, this is all, let's say, backbone processing. You have maybe your own stuff, and you can hand out some job to this Actinia server. It does the number crunching for you, you get back the result in a machine-readable way, and you continue with your further processing. Okay, and then, for example, you retrieve some, I don't know, a shaded elevation model or something like that. You can do import and export. We have some set of predefined functions there, but you can write your own, the Sentinel I already mentioned, and you can fetch data not only from the ESA API hub, but also from local storage if Actinia is deployed there. So through OpenEO, we are, I think, still discussing with some of the DIAs if we can get stuff into them or not. We also have, as a company, some discussions running. Amazon AWS and Google Cloud Storage is there. The advantage of those two, there's the star, is that the Sentinel images, I don't know if you're familiar with them, ESA delivers them as pretty huge zip files, like 1 gigabyte per scene, all channels in one and a lot of extra stuff there. But if you want to compute, for example, NDVI, which is two channels only, from ESA you have to download the entire gigabyte, you throw away like 900 megabyte and keep the rest. With these two, they have unpacked everything in the cloud storage, and you can just say, okay, I want channel 4 and channel 3. And that's so much faster. So no idea if ESA is planning to do anything about it, but at least this is a way to do. So for Sentinel processing, another example, you just say server URL, you say, I want to have the Sentinel 2 process, please compute the NDVI and use this scene. So this is the syntax, pretty easy. And then again, you send it, you get something back, it does the number crunching, and it tells you where to download the NDVI. Voila, there it is. Okay. What else is there? You can also store to cloud storage, to S3 and Google Cloud Storage. We have the so-called Actinia command execution in GRASS, this I will also show, which means we control from a running GRASS session, we control the cloud, which is a pretty easy way to generate these JSON files, because you can write your Python script or your shell script just like command, 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 and then you send it, and it's turned into automatically into a JSON and sent to the cloud. You can deploy own stuff as add-ons. Who's interested, I can show. Maybe we don't have the time for that. And we have OpenEO support, which is getting gradually better. I know there's a hackathon upcoming. Now, since 24 hours, we can at least be discovered, so this has been fixed. So in the OpenEO web editor, you see now the list of maps available and the processes. Still, some things have to be done. And with all cloud people on holidays at time, I'm not sure if we make it in time. OpenEO you have, I think, heard about, and then we are also developing Actinia Algebra, which is a tool to massively calculate in parallel. This is, of course, the entire idea about cloud, that you don't do just outsource your computation to a single node, because then you can also do it maybe locally, but to really split stuff into pieces and then do a massive parallelized number crunching and put results back into the final result. So what's upcoming? Implement more stuff and have also process self-descriptions so that we can probably also wrap it one day to WPS. Not sure about that, if we really want to do it or not. Reprojection support isn't yet there. We have to do a full refactoring. So this Actinia has been developed over a few years, but now we really want to refactor everything, make it more beautiful, and so on. This will happen at some point. Using Swagger 3, for example, is also one part, but it's a big job. So maybe, I don't know, 100 days of work, not sure yet. And we want to get rid of the Google Cloud connection somehow and probably do more stuff in-house, but it's also a bit of future, or we need to find some financing for that. That would be cool. And enable use of dynamic process chains. I think this is also related somehow to OpenEO and to be covered there. Well, that's basically it. Importantly, Actinia is an OSGEO community project, and you can, of course, join us on GitHub. The code is available. You can see there we have also a GDI, that is an interface to metadata management in GNOS, Geo Network Open Source, so that we can retrieve also where are the sources. So you put all the, let's say, all your list of metadata into GNOS, and then Actinia Core can ask, okay, tell me where I get this map. Or I have a bounding box, and I can retrieve, okay, what maps are available for this area from the metadata server, and you get the stuff back. We have satellite plugin and statistics plugin as separate plugins, and then we have the documentation, of course, of the API. Yeah, I think that's it, and available for questions.
So, hello everybody. Just about myself, I just arrived yesterday. I'm Madeleine Nussbaum. I work at the University of Applied Sciences in Bern in the agronomy department. And from the background, I'm a geographer, so I'm not a statistician. Please don't ask me about really the math in the background. I'm using machine learning and all this statistics stuff from the applied side. I can then rather provide experience on how it actually worked with my data and what were the advantages and disadvantages on the application. This presentation and the topic I work with is like Tom Hengel. I work on soil mapping or statistics with soil data in general. And this presentation, it's just some sort of a teaser for this afternoon's sessions. So you get an idea what to expect from these lectures. The sessions will be in the morning, and exactly the same session in the afternoon as well. And tomorrow I will have a second block that some sort of builds on the first one, and it's again in the morning, and a copy of it in the afternoon. So, what's the idea of my blog? The aim is basically that you get some background if you're really new to machine learning. I try to order a bit the stuff. You get an overview of the different strategies these machine learning methods use. And then you should be able to apply maybe 2 up to 4 if you are already quite a crack in R programming of these machine learning methods. And you learn to interpret, you learn to be critical also about it. A bit of the wording, it depends from, usually, if you check out books especially, you notice it depends from where the people come from, how they speak about it. But machine learning, in the end, it's some, for some part, it got started from the people from computer science. And the very classical statisticians, they were very skeptical, or are still today. They stick with like linear model, maybe additive model, where every things that are, it seemed to be a bit of a shift in paradigm. And so machine learning is something that is on the intersection of computer science and statistics and math. And I actually prefer to talk about statistical learning, because everything has also a mathematical background. People really like, they did the math behind it, so it's not just out of algorithms. And so that's also the books I consider quite to be recommended. I will show them citations in the lecture. They talk about statistical learning, or you could also say computational statistics. But it's all of a bit overlapping and the same. And there are like two, broadly spoken, two large fields One is unsupervised learning and one is supervised learning. Unsupervised, you just do, for example, a clustering of a satellite image. You group all the pixels that have similar values, and from that you form groups of land use, for example. But it's some sort of operates blind. You don't know how many classes you will get. You don't know how many groups you will form. You will find out during the process. This is unsupervised learning. And supervised learning, you already have a target you want to know. For example, in my case, I want to know the topsoil pH. I want to create a map of that. So I have a response value Y, and I have explanatory variables like rainfall, like geology, that can explain my pH. And this could be from other fields. This could be the presence of a bird breeding. This could be presence, absence of a disease. And everything that you could have on a map in a spatial context. And my lecture will just focus on the supervised learning part, just that you understand. I try to group all the machine learning methods. I will explain that this afternoon. There are many structures, like every book brings up their own ideas. Just different strategies of different methods that are behind here. So that's the overview. I will talk a little bit about overfitting and what's happening there. And the methods we will discuss is the lasso. That's a linear method with a machine learning algorithm behind. Support vector machines, quite famous. It's a non-linear approach. And ensemble learners like a random forest, the boosting, and the model averaging of different methods. The lasso, the shrinkage, it's a method where you put, this is the beta, the coefficient, you keep them smaller than in a normal linear regression. And like this, you have like a shrinkage factor where you pull them together. The support vector machines here for the linear case is built up from the data set where you split the data set, that these values then build up the actual models. And the value up here does not really play a role in the model fitting. And the famous random forests is basically regression trees that are combined in a clever way, that first they are built up and then combined. And the gradient boosting is some sort of a forward learning algorithm that slowly builds up your model and from that tries to adapt to your data. I try to give also pros and cons for every method so you have some sort of advice and can evaluate what's good for your application and for your data. You will work on, there are exercises with documented R code. I brought data that I used to work with in a soil mapping study area nearby Bern. So that's would roughly be the content. I hope I could interest you and see you maybe this morning or this afternoon.
Okay, good morning everyone. I will just make a brief intro to my tutorial this afternoon about analyzing space-time satellite data with GRASS-GIS for environmental monitoring. We will work with the monthly LST MODIS data, and we will show the different functionalities of the temporal framework in GRASS-GIS. So most of you already know a lot of basic concepts in GRASS-GIS, so this should be easier for you because the basis is already there. Then I'll tell you a little bit about me. Okay. also maybe you already heard it, but I'm a biologist, so like Madeleine, don't ask me about statistics or anything like that. And then I did a master in the Argentinian Space Agency on remote sensing applications, and that's why I kind of shifted a bit. And I actually do remote sensing and GIS applications for disease ecology, which was my original topic. I work as a researcher in the Argentinian Space Agency, and I'm also part of the GRASS development team and I'm a GeoCharter member. I used to teach GRASS courses, like also in Argentina, luckily now. but there are some videos around. There you have like all the contact information, my website and everything. You can check what I do if you're interested. So, GRASS-GIS has become like the first FOSS GIS that has incorporated these capabilities to manage, analyze, process, and visualize spatiotemporal data. But not only that, but also the relationship among time series, and that is something quite novel. So we call this temporal GRASS, we call it T-GRASS, so for short. This T-GRASS is fully based on metadata, and it does not duplicate any data set. So most of you already know the concept of GRASS data and how it is organized. So it does not duplicate any of that, but it's just based on metadata. So what we add, what this approach is called snapshot. So what we do is basically add a timestamp to the maps that we already have in our GRASS data, in our folder, okay? And then a collection of timestamp maps of this, like these snapshots, is then called a space-time dataset. So this is like, or when it was introduced, it was like a new type of data in GRASS, but it's just collections of either raster or raster 3D or vector maps. And the maps within these space-time datasets can have different spatial extents and different temporal extents as well. So, as I said before, then we have this space-time raster dataset, or STRUTS, and so on, with 3D raster and with vector data, with vector maps. That becomes a little bit difficult to pronounce. And since last Saturday, we also have support for image collections. You can see there in the link, that's the pull request that was merged, but that's only in the development version. So far we're not going to work with that. So some other T-GRASS notions that are important then for the tutorial. The time can be defined as intervals, so with a start and end time, or as instances or point in time, and we only use then start time. So like an image, a satellite image, for example, we would use this type, instance time. And then also time can be absolute, like defined as in Gregorian calendar. The minimum resolution would be 1 second. Okay, we can have time series per second. That would be like the minimum temporal resolution. Or we could define time as relative, and just then each map represents whatever, like 10 days, 1 month, 1 year. That kind of time is mostly used probably in simulations, for example, when you don't care about the actual date, but just how much time it represents. Another concept is this temporal granularity, which is the greatest common divisor of all the temporal extents of maps within a time series. So I always put the example of Modi's 8-day products here, because you would say, okay, which is the granularity of a time series of Modi's 8-day products? 8 days. Well, no. Because the last image per year, in each year, has like 4 days or 5 days. Okay? Because then every 1st of January, it restarts. And then the greatest common divisor of 8, 5, and 4 will be 1. Okay, so a granularity of that time series will be 1 day. And that is then important for different temporal operations that we have to do. Another very important concept that allows us to relate time series of, let's say, different variables, for example, LST and NDVI, and try to do operations among them, is this topology. And it refers to the temporal relationships between time intervals in a space-time dataset, or between space-time datasets. And so these are the relationships that are supported, a subset of the relationships that are supported, and some of them just change according to which series you put first. Okay. Another concept that has to do a lot with temporal topology is the temporal sampling, and that's how you, when you actually are relating two time series and you want to either sample one with the other, for example, you have a time series of vector data, and with that one you want to sample raster time series. So you see which raster will you sample according to the intervals of each time series. Okay, so in this table then you have how you sample each one, okay? And then the same as with all the modules in GRASS, they are organized with according to their functionality or according to the input data that they take. And so all the modules starting only with D will be related to general modules to handle time series. And then if they are T, RAST, and something else, those are specific for raster time series, and so on with raster 3D and vector. So this is a very beautiful plot. what I wanted to represent there is like the general framework and how the temporal framework is immersed or embedded into the GRASS data structure that we saw yesterday in the work, in the tutorials with Marcos. And so up there we have our GRASS database, that would be our GRASS data folder, okay, with our rasters, 3D rasters, and vector maps. And with those maps there, we can create time series just by assigning timestamps to them. Okay, so it's just adding some metadata. And what we do actually when we use this tcreate module, that is would be like the first step in the workflow, is just create a table that will contain like all the names of these maps that we will assign timestamps. Not only the names, but also it will include the spatial extent, the temporal extent, and the minimum and maximum value of the map. Okay, so it's indeed, in the end, a time series in GRASS. It's just a table with all the maps and the metadata. So we are not duplicating. We don't need to import the maps again and create a cube of maps or a stacks of maps and then like increasing the size of files, but it's just registering them in a table, which is the second step, assign timestamps to maps. And for that, we use a command called tregister. And like that, we get these space-time data sets for different types of data. And that is what we call the temporal database. And then after that, we can start our processings. We can use specific T modules, but we can also use some other modules in GRASScore or add-ons that are very useful for time series as well. So for visualization, for example, we have those models there, starting with GUI. So for timeline, we can do GUI tplot, like clicking in everywhere, like in a map. And if that map belongs to a time series, we then can see how the time series would look like in that pixel. Okay, so we get plots like that. Or we can do animations as well. Then we can do different listings, selections, extractions of maps, yes, always using the date or the variables that are stored in this table, yes. So we can select, for example, from one day to the other where the minimum is higher than something, things like that. Then we have some pre-processing tools like adding a color table or filling gaps, for example, like with just linear interpolation. Or we can use other modules to do gap filling. For example, our hands there, here, our hands, or local weighted regression as well. So for example, for NDVI, we could use our hands because it's like a periodic phenomenon, okay? And Hans is harmonic analysis of time series, so it's based in Fourier series. And then the core of T-Grass is the algebra part, and we have like also different modules there. We have different aggregations that we can perform, like these reducers that we were seeing in GDAL cubes. So one of them is T-RAS series, that would be like a temporal reducer in GDAL cubes. But then we also have this T-RAS aggregate that allows us to aggregate a time series according to a granularity that we can specify. So we can aggregate, I don't know, if we have monthly data and we want 3-month data, we just put 3 months. So, and that's it. And then your time series gets aggregated by every 3 months. And then the algebra. This is like super powerful module, but also quite complex. The syntax is quite complex, but it allows to do a lot of operations, like with spatial topology, with temporal topology, with different temporal operators. You can shift the time. You can snap the time, you can buffer in time. You also have like temporal neighborhoods, spatial and temporal neighborhoods, so you could create like space-time filters in your time series. There's a lot of things. We will use just some very basic examples. There's also algebra for vectors, and that would allow as well to do like buffering in space-time for vectors and such. Never used it. I never used it, so I actually don't know. And then we also have like accumulations, for example, to estimate growing degree days. For those of you more into, I don't know, maybe agronomy or some ecology, you know that plants and insects depend on temperature for either blooming or developing and such. And so you can estimate the growing degree days, and then according to the biological cycle of your other insect or plant or whatever, you can see where the cycles are met, when do they start or could start, and spatially where. So it's also really, really nice to see. Well, for me, it's really nice to see. And then afterwards, you can also import and export your time series and, for example, take it into R if you want. Yeah, and then there are like some other modules, for example, to extract information from the time series, like with just one vector, you get, you sample, you extract information from all the times, the raster time series, or zonal statistics from a time series and things like that. So what we will do is first a bit in, intro, a short intro about the data that we will use. Then we will go through modules, through these modules I showed in the diagram, explain them, and directly go to hands-on to create a time series, register maps in the time series, use algebra to convert MODIS LST that comes with in Kelvin to Celsius degrees. And then we will do some temporal operations like extract the date of the maximum LST of the year and the date of the minimum and things like that. Temporal aggregations, estimate climatologies and anomalies. And then we will do some exercise to estimate the, to calculate the surface urban heat island. You know that this is a phenomenon pretty important in urban areas that affects health and biodiversity and water management and different things in cities. And we will use this example to as an excuse to extract zonal statistics, both from urban areas and their surroundings, and then take this data to R and do some plotting. So I will show you in the very end of the tutorial how to connect GRASS with R. Okay? Like without leaving GRASS, just open R, bring our data, and do some plottings. Okay? Okay, we will use this already prepared location. It's actually the North Carolina location that comes with GRASS, but we added some things there. We added some map sets. One is for LST that we will use today, and one is for NDVI that we will use on Friday, which is the same lesson but with a different time series. So it was not that boring to repeat again the same. Sorry for that. So basically, you can start, if you want to take this tutorial, just start with downloading the data and the code. They are in the link. The North Carolina state is this one. There. So we will use data from this state. And as I said before, just a little bit more of detail about the data we will use. It comes from the MODIS 11B3 Collection 6 product. It's a tiled monthly composite. And that's the number of the tile corresponding to North Carolina state. It has a spatial resolution of 5,600 meters that corresponds to most climatic global models. And the selected time period is from 2015 until 2017. So basically that's it. And here I leave you some references of the developer of these modules and of this temporal framework is Soren Gebert, and Edser was the supervisor, right? And some other very useful links. For temporal, if you don't want to take the tutorial, you can just take some tour through these links. There's a temporal data wiki, and then a wiki connecting GRASS with R for time series as well, and some other workshops and courses around the world going from zero in GRASS to advanced. There are different flavors, some using more Python, some using more R, and so. And so please join and enjoy. And let's start GRASS. Friday is like the same. We will use all the temporal modules. We will just use a different time series for NDVI. And I will show you some add-ons to estimate, for example, seasonality and things like that. But basically, it's the same kind of functionality. So do not worry. If you took the base GRASS and then one of these, you are covered. Yeah, tomorrow, that's a different session. I will show you a bit more what I do. We will use a daily time series of LSD that Mundialis kindly gave us. It comes from a paper that we did together reconstructing LSD daily, because I want to extract meaningful information for to predict mosquito distributions. And so we will use like the biological limits, let's say, for growing mosquitoes, for the development of mosquitoes, and then extract variables according to that, like the number of consecutive days of freezing days, or the number of consecutive days with more than 33 degrees, because after that mosquitoes or larvae cannot survive, and things like that. So it's a bit more advanced in terms of algebra, of temporal algebra. And then once we extract these variables, the idea is to go to R, import the rasters, and try to predict the distribution of mosquitoes. The data from mosquitoes we will get also from within GRASS using GEBIF data sets. So we will just download from internet with an add-on specifically for that. And that's.
I would recommend to take a session today and tomorrow.
So today and tomorrow, it's like today and Friday, it's the same thing. And those two are different from tomorrow.
Okay, it's nice to be here again and present at the second year at the Open GeoHub Summer School. And the topic of my session is machine learning for remote sensing applications. And I promise you won't see any R code at all during this session, but instead I'm going to shift all the practical part to our practical sessions later on today. And what I want to talk about instead in the next roughly 20 minutes is some thoughts and ideas of what we might need to consider when we combine machine learning and remote sensing in the context of environmental science. And the general background of that is that in environmental science, we're often interested in spatial and spatial-temporal dynamics of different environmental variables, but usually the data that we have available to do this are only point data, for example, from climate stations or soil profiles, or sensebox data, if you think about your task for the spatial prediction competition. Let's make the problem that we have cleared that little forest patch here that is called the Marburg Open Forest, that is a little forest site in Marburg in Hessen in Germany. And that forest is a research site for a project called Nature 4.0, which aims at developing a spatial and spatial-temporal continuous monitoring system for environmental variables or ecosystem characteristics and biodiversity. And the data that we have available to study ecosystem characteristics in that forest is a network of sensors or of sampling locations that are distributed here over the landscape. And we can also have mobile data like attached to animals or to rovers. And these sensors now measure the ecosystem characteristics at the installed or at the visited locations. But initially, we do not know anything about the ecosystem characteristics in between these sampling locations. And therefore, our key question is now, how do we come from these point measurements to spatial continuous maps of different environmental variables? And at that point, there's usually no way around remote sensing, because remote sensing provides us with information in a spatial continuous way. So, for example, we can have data from sensors attached to UAVs that provide us with information in a very high spatial detail. We can rely on LiDAR data taken from airplanes that give us information on the vegetation structure. New satellite systems like Sentinel-2, together with a long time series of Landsat data, provide us with information in a spatial continuous way. And also data from geostationary satellites like from Meteosat provide us with spatial continuous information, and they have a very high temporal resolution, which might be interesting when we consider quite temporally dynamic processes like climate dynamics. So remote sensing provides us with information in a spatial or spatial-temporal continuous way, but for now this information are only reflectances in different wavelengths, but we don't know anything about the ecosystem characteristics yet. And therefore, our question is, how can we translate this information that we get from the satellite data to what we're actually interested in from an ecological perspective? And the way we can do that is to assume that our remote sensing information serve as proxies for the environmental variables. And this is very obvious for some variables that are directly linked to the satellite signal, like, for example, vegetation cover. So vegetation cover is quite well reflected by the information in the visible and near-infrared that we can get from remote sensing data. So what we can do is to set up a model here between remote sensing information, like the NDVI here on the x-axis, and field-sampled vegetation cover here on the y-axis. So what we can do, for example, as a very simple model, is to set up a linear model here. And we can apply the regression equation and apply it to each pixel in the NDVI data set to get a map of vegetation cover. So this is quite easy for variables that are directly linked to the satellite signal. But now for most problems in environmental science, that relationship is not that obvious. For example, when you think about rainfall or carbon in the soil or air quality or biodiversity, these are usually variables that are much more complex to assess, and they can often or usually not be assessed with such a simple function. So instead, what we need are models that are able to deal with the complexity of different environmental remote sensing information here, and we also need models that are able to deal with complex and nonlinear relationships between these variables. And this cannot be fulfilled by the parametric approaches, but instead we move here from the parametric approaches to the machine learning idea of modeling or of spatiotemporal modeling. And the general idea is that we have a set of remote sensing information that we call predictors here, and we assume that these remote sensing information have a relationship to our environmental variables that we're interested in. So what we do is that we feed these predictor variables into a machine learning algorithm, and this algorithm now learns the relationships between the remote sensing-based predictors and our measured ecosystem variables by itself. And in that way, it's possible that we can learn very nonlinear and complex relationships between these variables. And based on the learned relationships, the algorithm creates a model, and we can take up that model and apply it to each pixel here in our remote sensing data stack to make spatial predictions of our environmental variables. So this is a basic workflow of machine learning and remote sensing for spatial and spatiotemporal monitoring. But this is not necessarily a new method now in environmental remote sensing, but instead what we see is that this combination is used here since roughly the 1990s. But what we can also see is that, what we see here is an amount of papers published in journals in the context of environmental remote sensing, and we see that especially here in the last years, there's a huge increase in publications that use the combination of machine learning and remote sensing. But what is quite interesting when we have a look into these publications is that machine learning and remote sensing is usually applied in the same way as in other fields, like in medicine or economy, without consideration of the characteristics of remote sensing data. But our remote sensing data have usually characteristics that make them stand out against other data sets, and that's especially spatial but also spatiotemporal dependencies or autocorrelation in the data. And the key question of this talk is now if we can really ignore these characteristics in the data sets, or if we somehow need to consider the spatial dependencies that we have in remote sensing data if we want to create models that really have a value for environmental science. And I want to go into that question with a case study from that Marburg Open Forest, and the case study I want to discuss is a case study of a land cover classification. And land cover classification is probably the most classic prediction task in remote sensing. I'm also going to approach it here in the most classic way, which is that we use as training data digitized polygons that you see here for known land cover types. So we see here a set of different polygons for the different land cover classes that occur in the forest and in the area around that forest. And these polygons form our baseline for model training, so they actually present our training data that our model should be based on. So these are our response variables, our training polygons, And what we then need are predictor variables from remote sensing data sources or other spatial predictor variables. And what we use here are the spectral information from an aerial image, so the RGB channels. The green one is shown here as an example. From this, we can calculate some indices like visible vegetation index here, or also texture information like the standard deviation in a certain pixel environment. And what we also use here are some terrain variables like elevation, and we use geolocation information, in this case latitude and longitude. And we include these here as predictor variables because they have been often suggested by authors to improve the prediction performance of spatial machine learning models, and because they serve here as the perfect examples of highly autocorrelated predictor variables. So this is our set of training data, and to now learn the relationships between the remote sensing predictors and the land cover from training polygons, we apply a random forest algorithm, because this is probably the most frequently applied machine learning algorithm in environmental science and also in remote sensing. So we apply the random forest algorithm to learn the relationships between these predictors and land cover. But of course, such a model is only valuable when we know the error of that model, and of course, if the error is acceptable. So what we need to ask now is, how well is our model, so the combination of using these predictors and the random forest algorithm, able to really make predictions of land cover for our study area? So that's what we did, of course, and we did that with a default validation strategy, and when we have a look on how our model was able to map land cover, we see that the model has an accuracy of above 0.99 and also Kappa index of above 0.99. And keeping in mind that the maximum value that we can achieve for accuracy and Kappa is 1, we can talk of a nearly perfect prediction model here, and we could assume that we can continue publish these results now with good conscience, because we validated them with well-known validation procedures, and we obtained obviously quite good results for our prediction model. However, when we have a look into how our predicted patterns actually look like, so how our land cover classification that we produced here with accuracy of nearly 1 and Kappa of nearly 1, it doesn't look quite that perfect. So what we see here is our produced land cover map, and for comparison we have the RGB composite here to the left, and what we see are quite interesting patterns in our predictions. So we have a very obvious clear linear cut here between predicted grassland and predicted beech forest. And in our RGB composite, we see clearly a forest patch here to the east of the image that is misclassified as grassland here. And also that round-shaped patch of predicted Douglas fir seems to be quite suspicious. So all in all, I think you agree that doesn't look like a perfect land cover classification. The question is, how is that possible, because the statistics now told us that we have a great prediction model here, but what we see are predicted patterns that are very obviously not perfect at all. And to understand what happened here, let's have a look on how the prediction performance was actually assessed. And to do this, let's zoom in into the study area to the location of three training polygons here, one on cropland, one on grassland, and one located on a road feature. And what we did to assess the model performance was to apply the most commonly applied strategy, which is a random cross-validation. And what a cross-validation in general does is dividing our training data set into several folds. And then models are repeatedly trained by always leaving one of the folds out, and we're not using that fold for model training, but for model validation. And this is repeated until each fold is left out once, and then we average the performance over the folds, and then we get one error estimate that tells us how well our model is able to make predictions for data points that have not been used for model training. So that's the general idea of cross-validation, and the type of cross-validation that we applied here is the most commonly applied one, which is a random cross-validation. And what a random cross-validation now means is that our data are randomly divided into folds. So, for example, a first selection of folds of random data might look like this. So this means that all the data points that are marked here with a red cross are not used for model training in the first run, but are used to validate the model. And the same happens with the second fault and with the third fault and so on, until each data point from our training polygons is left out once and is not used for training but for model validation. And I guess you can already see the problem that we might have here, because by randomly dividing our data into folds, it is now most likely that in each of the folds we have the data from each training polygon. And in this way, it's possible that we make statements about how well our model performs on very similar or nearly identical locations. But what we actually want to know is how well our model is able to make predictions for those parts of the forest where we don't have training data for. So the aim of our prediction model is to fill exactly these gaps between these training polygons. And this is nothing we can estimate with a random cross-validation, but instead what we need is a spatial cross-validation that is really estimating how well our model is able to make predictions beyond the location of our training samples. And one suggestion to do that would be a spatial block cross-validation approach, where we divide our study area into spatial blocks, which is indicated here by the yellow grid. And what we then do for cross-validation is not to randomly divide our training data into folds, but that we systematically leave all training data from one spatial block out. So for example, for the first fold, we leave all data located at that block out, and we're not using them for model training, but to validate the model performance. The same we do with the second, with the third, and so on, until each spatial block is left out once. And when we apply this spatial cross-validation strategy on our data set, now the results or the statistical results change quite a bit. So now our accuracy dropped to 0.68 and also the kappa value dropped to 0.61. So apparently our model is less able to make predictions beyond the location of the training samples than we would assume if we considered the random cross-validation strategy here. And this now looks much more negative, so the values of 0.68 and 0.61 here, but this is really the accuracy or the error of the model in view to what we want to achieve, which is spatial mapping of the data. So what we can conclude here at that point is that spatial validation procedures can lead to an, standard validation procedures can lead to an over-optimistic view on a prediction performance, and we might draw completely wrong conclusions if we consider this random cross-validation procedure here. And that this topic is still quite underestimated in that community is also reflected by the editor's comment to one of our papers where we actually applied spatial cross-validation, which said, "I'm actually surprised to see the poor performance of your neural network approach. Typically, with sufficient training data, a neural network approach can often reproduce the predicted variable very well, even if the underlying reasons are unknown." But that's exactly our point that we want to make here, because data or reproducing data is not the same as making spatial predictions, because spatial predictions really means that we make predictions beyond the location of our training samples. And while the ability of the model to reproduce data can very well be estimated by a random cross-validation, the random cross-validation performance doesn't tell us anything about the ability of the model to make spatial predictions. And this, again, can only be estimated when we consider spatial cross-validation strategy that are really validating the model in view to what we want to achieve, which is a spatial prediction. But we agree with the editor in one point, and this is that our prediction is not really satisfying. Because first, we have a quite high spatial cross-validation error, and second, even if we change the cross-validation strategy to a spatial cross-validation strategy, our prediction model doesn't change. So even if we have a realistic error indicator now, we still have these obviously wrong predicted patterns of land cover. So what can we do to improve that? Well, I already raised the assumption that the spatially autocorrelated predictors might lead to problems here, and in this case lead to patterns of overfitting, and therefore can prevent a good spatial prediction. And in our data set, we definitely have predictors that are highly spatially autocorrelated, and that's especially the case for latitude and longitude, but also for elevation, where we have a high spatial autocorrelation in the data. And it's quite interesting to see that these three variables are also the variables that have the highest importance in the random forest model. So we see that these are ranked here as the most important variables, which means that the predicted patterns that we have seen are mainly driven by these three variables. But if it's true that these autocorrelated predictor variables lead to problems of overfitting and prevent a good prediction, then removing these variables from the models should theoretically improve our prediction results. So what we need if we want to automatically test for that is a spatial variable selection strategy that is testing for the for each set of predictor variables, which predictor variables can be used in this setting to make spatial predictions, and which ones have either no spatial meaning or might even be counterproductive because they lead to the patterns of overfitting that we have seen. And my suggestion so far to solve that problem is a forward feature selection strategy that works together with spatial cross-validation. And what this variable selection strategy does is to first test for each combination of two predictor variables, which two predictor variables lead to the best model. And the best model is defined here as a model that has the lowest possible spatial cross-validation error. And based on the best performing two variables, the algorithm increases the number of variables, and it is tested for each further predictor variable, which further predictor variable can improve the model. And improving the model again means that the spatial cross-validation error decreases here. And finally, the algorithm only keeps those variables that in combination lead to the lowest possible spatial cross-validation error, and it drops all those variables that either have no spatial meaning or even increase the spatial cross-validation error because they lead to the patterns of overfitting. And when we apply the forward feature selection with spatial cross-validation on this data set here, we see here the set of used variables or selected variables in decreasing order of importance. And we see that amongst our selected variables, neither latitude nor longitude nor elevation occurs here anymore. So apparently these three variables have been selected by the algorithm to either have no spatial meaning or to be counterproductive. So they have been removed and are not part of the prediction model anymore. So now our prediction model is only based on variables that have a spatial meaning, and our prediction patterns look on the first sight now much more reliable. So we obviously got rid of that clear linear cut here between grassland and beech forest, which could be clearly traced back to a misinterpretation of longitude in the model. Also that round-shaped patch of predicted Douglas fir is not in our new prediction model anymore because it could be traced back to a misinterpretation of elevation in the prediction model. And this is now also reflected in the statistical performance, so we could slightly increase the spatial accuracy and the kappa index, but more importantly, we have nearly no difference anymore to a random cross-validation, which means that we could decrease our problem of overfitting in the model. So what we can conclude here is that we need to consider the spatial dependencies in our data, and if we don't do that, there is a risk that we have a misinterpretation first of the model performance, so we have a considerably over-optimistic view on the model performance if we are not considering the spatial dependencies for model validation. So to validate spatial prediction models, we definitely need a spatial validation strategy. But we have also seen that the spatial dependencies in the prediction models can cause misinterpretations and lead to patterns of overfitting that also get very obvious when we visually look in our prediction results. So what we need in addition is not only spatial cross-validation for error assessment, but we also need a spatial cross-validation to select variables that have a spatial meaning or can be interpreted by the machine learning algorithm in remote sensing settings in a meaningful way. So the final conclusion of this might be that to answer ecological questions, we need to develop and of course also apply methods that are not focusing on reproducing our training data, but that we need to make sure that we're developing and applying models that are able to make spatial predictions, which is in most cases the aim of our tasks that we want to achieve in environmental science. So this was it for the theoretical part now, and in the practical sessions later on, I plan to really work on the example that I've shown now. So what I want to do is to show you how to set up a very simple prediction model to perform a land cover classification in R for those who never worked with a combination of remote sensing and machine learning. But then what we also can do, or if time allows, where we want to move on to, is to experience how different validation strategies affect the model performance and how we can improve the models by doing a spatial variable selection that should hopefully solve the problems of overfitting in the prediction models. Yep, that's it. So what you would need to make sure is always that your testing data are independent from your training data. So you should always use independent training or testing polygons in that case for model validation, so not the ones that you used for training. Or you really divide the study area into spatial blocks so that you make sure that you always leave complete parts of your study area out and test how well your model is able to make predictions for those spatial locations that you didn't include into model training.
So in that case,
cross-validation? No, cross-validation is fine. The question is, how do you do the cross-validation? Because you can do it randomly by just putting everything together and then randomly take some data points for training and for validation. But you can also do it more systematically by making sure that all the folds in your cross-validation as independent as possible from the data that you used for training.
Okay, there will be more room for discussion this in the follow-up sessions, I guess. Assignment, so this is a check to do see if we have room capacity problems and assign reporters for the wrap-up session. So who is planning to go to Marcus Nadler's cloud-based session in 242? Okay, that won't lead to capacity problems. Who is willing to report on that one in the wrap-up session? Great, Luke, yes, thank you. Who is going to the morning session from Madeleine Nussbaum? In room 323. Yeah, that should work out. And who is going to keep her or his hand up and will do the reporting on that one in the wrap-up session? Cool, great. Who is going to Hannah Meyer's morning session? Yes, okay, we have a nice distribution. And who will report on that one? Okay, great, thanks. Who is going to... Now the afternoon sessions. Who is going to Madeleine Nussbaum's session in 242? Yes, cool. And who will report on that one? Great, perfect. Who is going to Veronica's session on analyzing space-time satellite data with GRASS-GIS in the afternoon? Yeah, that should work. Who will report on that one? Cool, great, thank you. Who is going to Hannah Meyer's afternoon session? Oh, we have such a perfect distribution all everywhere. And who will report on that one? Cool, thank you. Okay, then we're all set for the coffee break. Thank you, everyone. Thanks for speaking.